KineticFlow is our solution to take the best computer vision algorithms and run them in real time in the car.
Welcome to Talking Autonomy. I'm joined today by Volkmar Uhlig, our CTO and co-founder here at Ghost. In a previous session, we talked about the unique approach Ghost takes towards AI, and in particular, our universal physics-based approach. Today, we're going to talk a little bit more about how that physics-based approach is manifested in a real network that we call KineticFlow, which is the main driving network for Ghost. So Volkmar, what is KineticFlow?
KineticFlow is our network which allows us to see the distance of objects, in which direction they are moving, and how big they are.
And, you know, of course, we talked earlier about the physics-based nature of KineticFlow. That helps us understand what end of the road might be an object. But the measures you talked about, distance, depth, and velocity of objects, that actually comes out of KineticFlow on a per pixel basis.
Correct. So that's the nice thing with our camera-based approach. We are only limited by the resolution of the camera. So if you're increasing the resolution of the camera, we get a more precise reading for all these measures.
Got it. Okay. So let's dive a little deeper into how KineticFlow works. My understanding is that basically we've taken a number of computer vision algorithms, both stereo and mono, and we're using those to train a neural network to give those outputs. Can you walk us through a little bit about the algorithms that go into it and this concept of training in the data center to run the algorithm in the car?
The algorithms we are using, they are well known in the image processing community. So we have stereoscopic vision, which takes a left camera and a right camera and then tries to figure out which pixels in the left camera or the similar pixels in the right camera. This is called establishing correspondence. Mm-hmm. And based on how far these pixels, the further they are apart, the closer the object is to us. Yep. And then if they are in the same spot in two camera images, the further away the object is.
Yeah, so traditional stereo vision, but we can do it at long distances because of the quality of our cameras. Yeah.
So the higher the resolution of the camera, the further you can look out. With that, we can now determine where or how close the objects are. And then you can do a similar approach in time. So you can look how over two consecutive frames an object is shifting between these between two consecutive camera images taken off a single camera. So now we can take both of those algorithms at the same time and compute the motion, and we can compute the disparity, so the correspondence between the two frames. And that gives us interesting information, which sometimes you cannot resolve from just one measure. So if you only look in the spatial domain, but you may clump two objects together, which are actually two. But if you look in the time domain, they may drive apart in different directions. Mm. And so the temporal domain gives us that discrimination of two objects, whereas in the spatial domain, we would only see one object.
Yeah, you've hit on a couple of very interesting differences here, I think, to traditional approaches. So many of the traditional vision approaches are either mono cameras where they're doing optical expansion, or they're stereo cameras where they're doing disparity in real time. Mm-hmm. But we've coupled kind of both those together into one network here. Yeah. So it's neither mono nor stereo, it's both.
Correct. Yeah. And there has been work in that space in the scientific community. I think the key difference here is that typically those algorithms are extremely compute heavy. So when you want to run them on a normal computer, it may, for a single frame, if you want to actually calculate this very well, it could easily take like 30 minutes to actually do the calculation.
Wow.
And so this is where our approach took that, where we are creating data in the data center and doing that really expensive calculation. And then we are training this into a neural network, and that neural network can then run in real time.
Yeah, I mean, this is another really important concept, because others have tried approaches where they've taken these really complicated algorithms, and because they're so intense, they come up with custom ASICs and bake them into hardware to try to run them in real time in the car. But we didn't take that approach. We're using the neural network to simplify the algorithm and run it in the car in real time.
Yeah, correct. And this goes back to our initial session where we talked about, the inspiration by biology. And I think this is very much along those lines, where, we are using a neural network, which is also what we have in our brain, to do those calculations. And they are approximations, but they are really good approximations, as we can see by humans.
Yeah, I mean, it sounds like you're basically creating approximations of what the world's best math would have done, but doing it, in milliseconds in the car, as opposed to in, half an hour in the data center.
Correct. Yes.
Pretty cool stuff. That's a great introduction to KineticFlow, basically a manifestation of our physics-based AI that takes that universal approach but uses a combination of mono and stereo computer vision algorithms to give you pretty much everything you need to drive, you know, the presence of objects, their distance, their velocity, and their direction of motion. Thanks for that explanation, Volkmar, and we look forward to future sessions where we learn more.
Thank you.